Welcome, everybody. My name is Mary Ann Francis, and I am happy to see you all here at the fifth and final Search Mastery Speaker Series presentation for spring 2021. We're exploring the foundations and practice of search, skills, education, and literacy. And today we're happy to have Jason Yip from the Information School at the University of Washington here to talk to us about how children of immigrant parents use their language and digital literacy skills to search and broker online information, a really super interesting topic. A little bit about Jason. He's an assistant professor at the Information School and adjunct assistant professor in human-centered design and engineering at the University of Washington. His research examines how technologies can support parents and children learning together. He's currently working on a National Science Foundation cyber learning project, where he's designing social media technologies to support neighborhoods learning science together. Jason is also the director of Kids Team UW, an intergenerational group of children ages 7 to 11 and researchers co-designing new technologies and learning activities for children with children. He's the principal investigator of a Google Faculty Research Award project that examines how Latino children search and broker online information for their English language learning parents. Also note, Jason's a University of Maryland alum, and he received a PhD in 2014 in curriculum and instruction from the university. So thank you, Jason, for joining us. We're looking forward to hearing from you.
Thank you. This is a really feels like a really interesting talk. I'm gonna share some things that I've never shared before, both on a personal level and on a research level in this case. So a little background about myself is that I consider myself like working in the learning sciences. I tend to study learning as it happens in the wild. I like to study families in particular, but I also study among like children in the community and often libraries in this case. So that's kind of where the iSchool-ish sort of deal comes in. I'm also studying a lot of child-computer interaction. I study a lot about co-design. A lot of the things I've learned from the HCIL really resonated in my work. And you know, and most of the stuff I work on is the modern family. Like, what is the modern family going through? However you define what modern and family means in this case. And in particular, you know, there's this growth. Everyone sort of worries, like, oh no, like we've got technology addiction, and maybe not so much anymore since COVID. COVID may have taught us a lot about technology addiction now, but this is always really, really interesting areas to study, given the fact that families have changed so much throughout the nature of like the past 50 years. Like, we're seeing a lot, you know, different kinds of families now, families that are, you know, multi-generational, and all these factors really shift about how we think the ways that families interact. And so my big question has always been now around, how does digital technology influence how families, certain parents, children, communities collaborate and learn together? And in particular, I'm really interested in this idea of joint media engagement. What is this sort of new co-viewing? Sesame Street defined co-viewing before in the 70s as, you know, parents and children watching TV together synchronously in the living room. And that is like, doesn't happen anymore. It's like, who watches TV together live stream anymore? It's always a little foreign. And in some ways, it's just a very different kind of world now. In particular, with joint media engagement, we might think about things such as mutual engagement, how do families work together, a dialogic inquiry, what kind of conversations are happening, going on, co-creation, what are the ways that families actually work together to solve problems or to build certain things, build ideas, boundary crossing, what does it mean that like, people can actually, you know, how does a child understand what a parent is going through? How does a parent understand what a child is going through? What is the ways that people are growing? How does technology help us level up or change our perspective of who we are? And the idea that like now technology is certainly helping us focus on content, not control. What is it that like, you know, instead of having these extremely complex, you know, keyboards, now we actually have smartphones. Now we have touch. So we can focus much more on the content instead of the control of these sort of things. And so it's really, really important to think about this sort of joint media engagement as Henry Jenkins talks about, you know, what does it mean to lower the barriers to to artistic expression and civic engagement? What does it mean to help us, you know, create and share? What's the kind of informal mentorship that even occurs, even among families, and what kind of safe spaces happen and the kinds of degrees of social connections? One of the most particular ones is that, like, we need to understand participatory culture, the new form of hidden curriculum shaping which youth will succeed and which will be left behind as they enter the workplace. And in particular, it's really, really, you know, we think a lot about it maybe in terms of, some folks think about it in terms of the middle class, who, you know, likely to rely on resources and assistance from peers and families when their own homes. But what about the, what about other children, like, who might have to also figure this way out, especially heavily on teachers and peers? And it could be, and they sort of talk about this lack of experience at home, but I would argue actually that that might not, Jenkins' like argument may not work as well for this one. In particular, I think actually there's a lot of experience at home right now that's really, really both positive, but also tension filled. And so today's talk is going to be a little bit of a reflection on this work on joint media engagement for critical family information needs. This is work I've been doing with Laura Pina, Carmen Gonzalez, Carolina Nieto, and Wendy Roldan, and really trying to understand these sort of information practices. But so this is the part of the talk I'm going to put a little pin on it for a moment. So just hold on to this for 1 second. I'm actually going to give a positionality statement. I don't normally give a statement like this, but I think this is a particular talk that actually requires the audience to sort of know who I am a little bit. I don't ever really show this picture. This is a picture from like 2003 of my grandparents turning 90 years old. There's a lot of people in this family that, you know, my family came over on the wave of immigration in like the 1970s. Some of the people in this photo speak perfect English. Some of the people in this photo do not speak English at all. And like, for example, my grandparents who basically have lived, who lived here before they passed away for 40 years, and they didn't speak any English, very, very little in this case. Some people in this picture are recent immigrants. Some people in this picture have been in America since the 1970s. And so what's really interesting is that even though this is a photo of us from like 2003, today, this is my wife, this is my mother-in-law, this is my grandmother-in-law, and this is my dog. I have to show my dog because it's just who I am now. Today, my mother-in-law and my grandmother-in-law actually don't speak English either, right? They actually live in Bethesda, Maryland. We are actually moving them over to Seattle over the summer. And believe me, like, the moving is really interesting given the fact that, like, you know, we are searching on the internet right now. Like, I'm 40 years old. My wife is also doing this kind of stuff. So this is sort of near and dear to my heart, this kind of work. And a little bit more about positionality, about in the summer of 2010, I joined the HCL at University of Maryland. I'm not an iSchool student. I always tell people, but I'm from the College of Education. So part of my coming over in 2010 was that, like, my advisor had left the University of Maryland. So I was kind of lost. I was like, oh no, like, what you're seeing in this picture is a very lost graduate student, right? I was sort of like, okay, well, I was thinking about doing my dissertation on social media and science learning, right? And then I was recruited to Kids to UMD. But I didn't really know what HCI was, and I certainly didn't really understand what iSchool was, given that I was from a College of Education background at the time, studying curriculum and curriculum and instruction. And so two people at the HCIL that really influenced a lot of my work was Allison Druin, who you might have heard of before, and Elizabeth Foss at Center Left. And they both were like, you know, since you don't know what you're doing, why don't you come join us on this project called, like, you know, Children's Search. And so from about 2011 to 2012, I'm like driving all around Maryland to learn how children search the internet. So it might be because I had a car at the time. And also I didn't really know what I was doing. I was kind of like, well, I know I'm supposed to do a dissertation. I'm kind of hanging out here at Kids Team at Maryland. You know what, I'll just figure this out, right? Because I really want to learn more about what an iSchool is and what this is. So I'm driving all around Maryland and Virginia with Beth Foss, and we're going into people's homes, studying how they're searching the internet, particularly children in this case, from ages 7 to 11, and also 13 to 16 in this case. And so we were able to publish our first paper, Adolescent Search Roles in JSIS. And this is a paper that really talked a lot about, you know, the kinds of searchers that you know, youth can be. And but there's a bit of limitations in this paper. Like I said before, I was driving around Maryland and Virginia, mostly the middle, again, that question of middle class homes. It was the very first set of search studies for children in the home. So we figured we had to sort of understand like just, you know, mainstream background. And in particular, you know, I'm still trying to figure out like where does search like fit in what my thoughts about like learning in this case. So, you know, we wrote this paper, I was great. I feel like, okay, maybe this is sort of this one-off thing. It was great, you know? And so I graduated in 2014, but I still kind of feel lost. I'm like, all right, I finished my dissertation. I have some idea about co-design, but does searching fit? I don't know. It sort of is like, I just wasn't really quite sure. So because I was kind of lost, you know, you kind of go here. I went to the Joan Ganz Cooney Center at Sesame Workshop from 2013 to 2014, trying to understand, and this is a research think tank in Sesame Workshop focused on families and technology. So I was like, this is perfect. Like for my postdoc, I'm really, really gonna understand. This is my sort of obligatory, like I was in Oscar's can. This is the original trash can. So that's I have to put that in. But this was a really influential time, not just because I found myself in Oscar the Grouch's trash can, but I met a really great researcher named Vicky Katz and her postdoc, Carmen Gonzalez. And sometimes like, I always tell people that like, oh, you know, if you ever have lunch with me or you have coffee with me, it is sort of a dangerous time because you'll come out having more work or I will come out having more work. And Vicky was really, really instrumental in this book called Kids in the Middle, How Children of Immigrants Negotiate Community Interactions with Their Families. So I had lunch with Vicky and I was like, I want to understand all about this. This sounds really cool. And so in New York, we're having lunch. And she tells me about how a lot of the kids in her book really were focusing on brokering. How do they translate information when it comes to like digital media, when it came to like television, or it came to like, you know, aspects of the computer? How do immigrant children teach their families how to use computers and use technology? And then all of a sudden it dawned on me, like I did search in Maryland. I just covered that whole thing. And so I asked the question, did you ever study kids searching the internet and brokering? And she said, no, there's actually been no studies, right? They allude to it. And then like, you know, but we don't have actually never done this before. And I was like, oh my gosh, like this could be part of the thing that like, I'm not lost anymore. Like it kind of came to me in a moment because it really helped me understand like, what is it about technology and families and even my own background that helped me understand like what was going on. And so, we define search and brokering as, you know, just children's duties beyond the traditional chore and being the role of the family information seeker and problem solver. One of the reasons why we're seeing a lot more of this is in 2012, we documented about 25 million English language learner individuals ages 5 and older in the US. Now, this is old census data from like 2010. I'm kind of curious, like in the next like 2 years, what the census will look like, given that we just completed it. So this will be old statistics. I imagine it might be more, but again, I don't know, but we'll just sort of take this statistic for a moment. But even if it's just like this older statistic right now, even this came out in 2020 as COVID sort of came, when a 10-year-old translated for her parents on live radio, thousands recognized themselves, right? It's like this like, whoa, hold on. Like it's not just it's still here, right? This idea that people are still trying to take language and information and trying to summarize it for somebody else or working together to figure this out. And so when I first started doing this work, we did it as a pilot study in Brooklyn, really interviewing a bunch of kids on their search practice. So as soon as I met Vicky, I was like, we got to get an IRB. We really, really totally have to like study this right now. So for like during that time, I really wanted to just like, you know, I really want to just understand like just the heart, at least like what happens by interviewing some kids and do some search tasks. So we found out there were like some really, really interesting kinds of searches that were happening, and I'll talk about them in a moment. And so this was sort of laid the groundwork of those very first interviews in Brooklyn, laying the groundwork because we knew again from national surveys and interviews that online search and brokering happens. We also know like, you know, lots of different things from like information sciences and the learning sciences about how people search. This is Brand Grunwald's information problem solving model, right? And it's a very individual model. I personally like this model a lot. It's actually kind of really interesting. looking at a process of how people search the internet and how they find things. But I had some problems with this model because one of the things that it doesn't tell me much about what's going on in Latin immigrant and refugee families and what does it happen when it doesn't tell me the how, right? It just sort of says like, here's what search is on this sort of kind of, you know, informational level, on this sort of cognitive level, on like the individual level. But really, like, that's not explaining this part of the story, which is like what happens when we go in, when we want to understand. So part of the big study in 2017 was really trying to understand the nature of online search and brokering, particularly among bilingual Latino families. So this is after Brooklyn, after my time at the community center, I finally landed at the University of Washington and started realizing like, okay, we should start doing this more now, right? So I work with Carmen Gonzalez. She also ends up being a University of Washington comm professor. And we started coming up with these two questions. What's the nature of online search and brokering among bilingual Latino families, Latinos being one of the fastest growing lower SES groups in the country, but also the largest immigrant groups in this case. And how do Latino youth collaborate with English language learner adults to engage in online information problem solving for family needs? So in this particular study, I took all those lessons I learned from the HCIL, right? Like, so HCIL is a great place. Like, you can learn to do a lot of things. And one of the things I learned was driving around Maryland and Virginia really taught me about how to go into people's homes. So we went to the homes of 24 families at the time. We interviewed them for the first round. And then after visit one, we did some interviews separately with the parent and the child. Then visit two, we did these in-home search tasks, right? Things I learned from Dan Russell, who you may have seen like from the prior talks. He was the one that sort of taught me a lot about home methodologies. What does it mean to search in person? So I take a lot of the lessons I learned from working with children, actually put tasks together for youth and their parents to search together for us and kind of demonstrate brokering. It's not perfect because we were there, but it was trying to just model a little bit of what we could do. And then finally, some final interviews and participatory photography, ways that families documented themselves. So our first research question was about the nature of online searching and brokering among the bilingual Latino families. And like I said before, when I first did the study in 2010, 2011, with Beth Foss and Allison Druin, this was unheard of. Like, it was never like together, right? But we found that like, yeah, it was true. Like we went to the homes and they talked a lot about these certain things. This is a mother and her daughter are really talking to us about the kind of dynamics. Sometimes we saw a lot of parent-child. Sometimes we also saw multiple families working together. On the right corner here on the far left is a father. And then on the right, you might not be able to see this person's body, but there's a this is the mother and this is the teenage daughter. This particular youth, she was searching a lot on how to like do car sales on Craigslist. And I remember them searching as well for health, lots of health. So multiple families often work together. They often said like, it isn't just parent child, but it is also us together. This is a particular searcher. This is, he's in middle school, the young child here. He was at the time of the study, was like 11 or 12. This grandfather owned a restaurant. And basically like he was trying to help him find how to run the restaurant, how to find recipes, how to actually even replace certain parts and actually even helping his grandfather navigate health insurance. And so I was like, whoa, it's not just, this is the first time we documented grandparents and grandchildren searching together. We also had extended families, aunts and uncles. In this particular picture, the person in the middle right here is the niece, and this is the aunt. And they're searching again, like they're basically saying like, yeah, like I come over, she's at the time 21 years old, and she's like, I'm coming over to this house right here doing the search, right? I bring my laptop and I've been helping my aunt do this thing, right? So, and we didn't just see it with extended, this was a particular group. This is not her mother, right? This is family friends. They were the same, they were basically trading children around, passing them around and said like, here, help our neighbor, help our friends, help each other right here, right? And again, like what happened was very different from the 2010 study versus now was the multiplicity of devices. Not surprising, but how much more complicated things got, right? So when I was doing the study with Beth Foss in 2013, all we saw were laptops and desktops, right? Not surprisingly, things have exploded out to tablets, smartphones, and the likes and everything like that. In this particular one right here, this is, I don't know if you can see it or not, but this is actually two different people searching. This is the mother's hand is on the top and the daughter's hand is on the bottom. And they're doing this. And I was like, wait, is this something that you all do together? They're like, yeah, we hold the phone together like this, right? They kind of like look through it together. So this is a smaller device. And it's like, wait a second, like this is how you're searching. Like you're actually putting two thumbs together, like, but one thumb is coming from a, but with two bodies. That was like sort of incredible for us. Like I'd never seen anything like it as they were kind of searching around for things. This is a MiFi device, right? This family's internet is not very good. So the niece brings a MiFi device from like the local library and brings it over with their computer. And sees. In particular, it's very, very important for laptops. Even though like, you know, I'm showing this particular one with the phone, laptops still were really, really important because they were searching up things for FAFSA and other kinds of student loan kind of things right there, right? So again, you just can't search a lot. It isn't that the screens still matter, right? The form factor still totally matters in this case. In research question two, we looked at how do Latino youth collaborate with English language learners to engage in online information problem solving for family needs. We knew this happened, right? We knew that there would be a lot of unidirectional, meaning that like families would tell their child, here, find the map for me. Here's the address, find this location for me, go. Right, a lot of fetch requests, like that's not surprising to us. What was more interesting was actually the bi-directional, like how parent and child needed each other to do the search task. And we were just like floored by how collaborative it had to be. So I'll give you two examples. The first one is in a family 22, Yara's sitting in the middle. She's age 16 and she's helping her mother, Elena, search for employment opportunities for Pablo. Pablo wasn't around, but they're like, okay, your dad needs to find work, right? So let's look for work for him. So in Spanish, Elena is asking Yara to search for construction jobs for Pablo. And in the desktop browser bar, she's typing, you know, in English, construction companies hiring near me. But like, this isn't really helping her. Like the daughter is like, and the mother's like, this isn't exactly what we need to find. Like, I'm not sure what this is. And as a Yara is like, well, I'm not sure what you want me to search for. And so Yara, they eventually start realizing like, we can't just find construction jobs. We have to actually find siding, right? Like your father does siding. And so Yara is asking like, I don't know how to even spell siding. Like, what does my dad do? Like, I don't understand this job, right? So Elena's mother is like, you know, we got to look through the paperwork, right? Here's the actual certificate your dad has. This is his job. And so like they point and then, you know, there it is. And so it's like, it's beyond the digital. You actually have to go look in the home. They had to hunt and find for information right there, right? Outside the actual like, you know, computer screen. And like Yara continues to sift through the job listings, deciding which job postings are a good match to translate. She then asked like, you know, questions about how much do they pay, and Yara's like $20 an hour. And what they come to realize is actually Yara's not doing the search right. Mom's like, no, $20 an hour, like this is not gonna help us. Like we're looking for the big projects. And it turns out they start to realize like, she's not looking for a specific construction job for a husband. She's looking for construction projects. Like, no, your dad is like the person that over, I'm looking for big projects for us to take on, right? And so that had to narrow all of a sudden from like construction job to like construction siding to like actual projects, right? They actually didn't end up finding the work, but it was really interesting, again, having to like search through the home, having to negotiate and talk through these things, having to actually like work together and sitting down in this case. Right? It gets even more complicated with health and financial literacies. Carmen Gonzalez on our team wrote a fantastic paper writing about intergenerational online health information seeking. It gets really complicated with the collaboration for health once we start to see it. Like, so for example, this is a really interesting one right here. Like my dad's shoulder pain, this is Teresa talking. He gives me descriptions to put it. There are so many things that it could go with. So I'm like, I don't really know what's wrong with your shoulder. It might be a nerve. I don't know what it's called, but there's lots of remedies that you can help with it. I can never tell him, oh, it's this specific one, when there are hard words in English to Spanish. And sometimes I don't know how to describe them all that well. I don't know the word in Spanish. So that's when it gets hard translation-wise, any sort of medical word and terminology. So here you can't do unidirectional search. Like my dad says, I have shoulder pain, help me find this information, right? One of the things that's happening right here is that Juan, her father, needs to be specific when describing the shoulder pain, almost like how you would be providing a medical medical provider. You can't just say like, oh, hey, pain, search for it. It's like, where is the pain? How much is the pain? Where does it hurt? Is it between your arm? Is it between your, like, where, what's happening right here? And as I said before, with the Brand Grunewald information process searching model, again, it doesn't really quite show all the things that are happening, right? There's lots of things that are happening that we can see, right? Defining the problem, search information, scan, process, organize, and your reading and evaluation skills. But we would argue that, like, whoa, 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 like, you know, certain types of searches actually matter more with the internet right there, right? So if we look at the Teresa case right there, the father, she has to process first the father's request. Like, okay, like, where is the shoulder pain? Like, what is going on right here? She has to ask the right questions to follow up. It's not just, so she has to come up with the right questions first, like before we even go to the internet, like, what's your shoulder like? You know, then like find the pot, then finally do the search, run and sort of find the possible diagnosis or treatments, figure out the medical advice based on the online information gathered, and do this while navigating two languages, right? Like, so this, you know, setting right here doesn't quite cover what this is. This is partially, like, it's there, but the fact that, like, there is no, there's a question and answer period, there is a sort of like search for it, there is the going through multiple languages. It's very complicated. So part of our work in that CSCW paper that I sort of showed on was that we have to take an ecological perspective of internet search. It's not, so ecological systems theory comes from Uri Broffenbrenner from the 1970s. It's a really old theory that really says that, like, you know, the individuals are oftentimes influenced by aspects of the microsystem of the families. Those microsystems are also then affected by the mesosystems, which could be communities or neighborhood groups, or exosystems, which is like the infrastructures of the actual, like, you know, aspects of the world, and the macro system, the cultural aspects. And we found that, like, you know, this ecological system theory fits really, really nicely with search, because, you know, unlike the individual factors that we can sort of see in the Brand Grunewald and other models like it, we have to really consider the fact, okay, well, there is the individual model, but there's also the social collaborative model, looking at language skills, right? Like, what are the individual factors, such as, like, you know, how does a kid, like, deal with, like, technical language? How does the family deal with technical fluency, right? The microsystem, like, who's around? Like, is it the family? Is it the peer? Is it the sibling, the extended family, or the neighbors? Also, do the families have access to different things? Like, did the child learn search in school? What about the libraries? What about the community centers? Where some of our families actually went to more community centers for the search. And that was actually really interesting to see how they versus, like, families who were more isolated. We had families who lived very far from any neighbors, and they were just like, we drove far away, almost 30 miles to certain places to do these interviews. And we're like, oh my gosh, like, they're really isolated. Then you have this exosystem that we're really seeing now, even with COVID, like the technology infrastructure, right? The fact that, like, you know, we've got multiple devices, and some of those devices, like, what if I only have a smartphone, and how do I search for, you know, big forms like FAFSA or, you know, employment and things like that, right? How do I, what about the policies of broadband? Like, that, we have MiFi devices right now. We're seeing that now here in COVID. And then the bigger factor of familism, the cultural values that kind of take place, the obligations that youth might feel to do this kind of work. So one of those big questions is that, like, there's these tensions right here. There's always been tensions when it comes to, like, youth and brokering, right? It's not good or bad, right? I think one of the things that I always want to sort of say is that, like, there is this positivity, right? There is this thing like, wow, we have really incredible searchers. These kids are, like, doing things like on an amazing, but there's also this, like, oh my gosh, they're doing this? Like, I don't know if I want a child searching for cancer at the age of 11, right? I don't know if, like, I want my child to know all of the financial happenings that are going on, right? And so it's about this, like, you know, and I think the other point that I also want to drive in is that, like, not all youth technology and design can be thought of as like this sort of fun and educational. I think or health, we tend to think about child computer action for much more of a oh, like childhood is innocent. And I'm like, and I'm sort of arguing like, not really. Like, I actually think childhood is really hard. It's really hard for a lot of families. And that, you know, it was hard for me growing up, it was hard for a lot of other families growing up. And that we need to actually start thinking about joint media engagement, not as this sort of like, oh, dialogue. I mean, there's lots of great things. I study it all the time, like games and learning and this sort of social media and science learning. But then there's this sort of critical needs background. Like, oh my gosh, like, wait a sec, what's going on in our youth? Like, particularly when we start to think about the sort of investigations that sort of have to happen. And so once we did this study, I was kind of like, you know, I really, really was like, okay, this is cool. Like, we got this one group down, but there's this, like, there's so many, there's just like so many people out there, right? So I applied for the NSF career and got it. And one of the big questions I really wanted to understand was much more like, what on what levels has it happened now on a bigger scale, right? Different families. And also, so these are sort of a research question that sort of came about when writing this proposal. What kinds of invisible work do youth perform? We sort of knew about it more from the Latino family side, but now we want to explore like other kinds of families that, like, you know, from other English language learning families. What kind of design patterns, techniques, and frameworks can be used to embody like the socio-ecological supports, the funds of knowledge, the family resilience, the kinds of theories that help teach us things. Like, we started understanding much more about the ecological system theories, but we really want to know more about the funds of knowledge, the kinds of assets and experiences that youth have in these kinds of, and also the family resilience. That's a theory that comes from communications to talk about how do families actually, you know, stay together, right? How do they survive? How do they do kind of this kind of stuff? And in research question three, we started thinking a lot more in this grant, like, how can design patterns for invisible work be instantiated with sociotech? How do we actually design for this stuff, right? How do we actually consider design? And so when I wrote up the NSF career, I was like, yeah, I'm going to be super ambitious. The five-year plan, here's my five-year plan, right? We're going to start with, again, this empirical investigation. It's going to be great. We're going to go into people's homes again. And this time we're going to go really targeted. This time we're going to really focus on much more of the health searches. We're going to look for much more of the financial information. It'll be great. We're going to do these in-home interviews and search tasks. We're going to do it on a bigger scale. And then, we're going to do these conceptual investigations, right? We're going to do co-design, and we're going to work with, like, different kinds of families together and actually bring them together and actually start to understand what's going on here. How can we actually integrate design now? Because we hadn't actually co-designed in that sense. And then finally, maybe we could actually build something. Maybe we should build prototypes to start to understand like what all this is, and then finally kind of come bring it all together. So I had this really big, ambitious plan for the NSF career. But as it turns out, I got the NSF career awarded the first week of March 2020, and then COVID then shut UW down in the second week of March 2020. It was all of a sudden like, oh no, like everything, like the very, like literally, like I got the money, I was like, yay, and then, oh, like, I had to change a lot of things up. This is kind of like, all right, we can't do the in-home studies. Like, in-home is not cool anymore. IRBs don't let us go in home. Like, I had to revamp everything. So we're like, we're gonna have to focus on the empirical investigation a little bit later. We're gonna have to, the only way to do the study is now, actually, we've got to co-design. We have to jump into the co-design portion right now, right? And had to change that part to online co-design. I had to change, had to know more, and then maybe later on we'll do more. We'll do some interviews, but we can't do the search tasks that I really wanna do, that I normally would wanna see in the home. That one we'll just have to table for later. So a lot of this next portion, smaller portion of this talk, will focus a little bit more on what we've been doing with the conceptual investigations. We've been working with the East African Community Services here in Seattle. They're a community organization that supports immigrants and refugees from East Africa and Seattle. If you know anything about East Africa, it's really big. It's like gigantic. And there's like lots of languages. So even though like I'm focusing on kind of like more immigrant refugee populations from East Africa, they're actually very heterogeneous. They speak Somali, they speak Amharic, they speak Swahili, they speak French, they speak English, all together here in Seattle. There's at least 10 different languages that are happening here. with the most part with these youth. And so we've decided like, okay, but again, but luckily, well, not luckily, but I would say like the common thing that is going on is that there is some limited English, although they do bring in within the East African Community Services, they do bring translators. And so there is a sort of large network of youth support that this particular group allowed us to like partner with them. And so we really focused on asset-based community activities. What is it that like we can understand? My doctoral student, Wendy Roldan, is doing this for her dissertation. What are the kinds of ways to work together with the staff, right? We really wanted to make a co-design project that was much more like, we're not gonna come in with these sort of ideas about how search happens or how design happens. We worked very, very hard together with Faiza and Mallory, who are two of the workers there at the center, two of the employments, really trying to figure out like, what are the things that are happening right now in the home? We did a lot of recruiting of the students. Obtaining consent was really, really interesting, like having to have it in multiple languages, and also planning our sessions together with culturally appropriate activities, right? Really trying to emphasize. And so some of those things, so, you know, again, this is online, you know, our youth don't really, some of them like to turn on the camera, most of them do not. So that was another issue, like how do you co-design when the cameras are off? That's a paper, another paper for another time. But, you know, we did a lot of welcoming, a lot of card sort tasking, a lot of comic boarding, a lot of panel drawing, like, you know, giving them blank panels and trying to draw in like what was going on at the home right now these days. I'm sure trying to get, again, understand health searches, particularly among COVID, financial searches among COVID, and even education searches. I'm really trying to do this. As I sort of begin to wrap up, I'm not going to be able to have, I don't have any deep lessons right now because we just literally finished collecting the data in like January. So we aren't done yet. We still have to process all of this. But the things that I can say so far about this new set of data as it pertains to search is that there's a cyclical nature, right? They keep talking about the same thing over and over. Like it never really quite ends. Like it's always like, yeah, I keep doing this, right? I keep doing the password. I keep uploading the images. I keep searching to find these things, right? The second point is probably the most surprising to me. I think there is triumphant sentiment. Like the kids are proud. They are happy to find the answer, but there's also silent sentiment of honoring the work as parent, what the parents do. They don't want to talk about it that much. They often say like, well, it's not really me that did this. Like my parents did this, right? My parents are the one that took care of it. I really just didn't do anything. And so we were like, what? Are you serious? Like, you sure? Like you're telling us all this stuff. And like, and so there's this really interesting factor about like what they think about themselves. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a moment. And one of the reasons this invisible work is work, it's invisible because it's actually hard to articulate, right? One of the biggest challenges when we were doing co-design was the youth were in EACS were much more like, oh, like it's just searching. Like, what's the big deal? But I mean, like, for example, like right here, we did a web with the youth, and they were asked, we were kind of trying to figure out like, okay, we want to just sort of understand like what kind of financial searches happen, right? This is sort of the things that are going on. One of the things we started realizing was some of them, like if you look on the right side, they started talking about buying and selling stocks. And I'm like, wait a second, hold up a minute. You're 12 years old. What do you know about buying and selling stocks, right? And like, we're like, oh, wow, are you an investor? And they're like, no, like my dad's the investor. Like I don't do anything but just find the information, right? Or the idea of like, you know, jobs in this case, right? Like, what do you think about, you know, finding information for your jobs? And they're like, it's my parents that need the work. Like, I'm just here to help out. And so it was really, really interesting to sort of see like that sort of silent sentiment. We didn't see a lot of like, oh yeah, I'm a searcher. I'm super proud. I can find these guys. We found a lot of like this is no big deal. This is just like this is our responsibility. We're told to do this. This is like what we do. Another thing that we sort of saw was in this particular case, we saw a lot more siblings. This is one that was actually, well, especially around education with COVID. This is a particular one that a child drew up for themselves. Description, my brother asked me to help with homework. He doesn't understand after I tell him for a long time. So I decided to turn on a video on Khan Academy. And after the video, he still doesn't fully understand. So I put on a different video and now he knows. But the other video describes more about fractions. Right? So we're seeing different kinds of searches now. We know that youth look for information on videos, right? We know that siblings help each other, but this is like one of the very first times we're starting to understand like how COVID impacted the world, how that also meant that siblings had to also begin to take care of their other siblings as they do kind of these searches right here in this case. Finally, to sort of wrap up, we'll also be doing a lot of work with searching as it comes to like the UW Dream Project. This is a group of undergrads that are first generation undergrads at the University of Washington. They are for the most part, the first person in their homes to actually go to college. And a lot of these students, undergrads are, they're also searching. They also talk a lot about searches. And one of the things, the reason why we want to look at adults, particularly like undergrads, is as I said before, when I did this search, I'm just gonna go back to the, really quick. This is kind of why I did a bit of a background about myself. When I did this search right here from 2011 to 2012, like I missed all those stories, right? I missed like the immigrant and the English language learner stories because we just didn't have any. Right. And like, so there's a sort of like, I almost feel like there's this like lost set of stories that we need to sort of archive and we need to bring out and because we didn't bring them out. Like this is, they were not part of this paper, right? They were not part of this group. And so I don't have a time machine. I can't go back into the world to see what the searching was like back in 2010. But so we decided like, okay, we're going to have to do retrospective interviews with whatever limitations we have with undergrads and start to work with them as well to think about, you know, how searching sort of affects who they are as college students. Now, today I'm still interviewing this week. Like I have some interviews today. But one of the things that I think is really, really, again, quick lessons that we sort of gotten from these interviews right now is when we started interviewing some of these, like these undergrads, all the participants, and these undergrads are coming from like, they're from the Middle East, from like East Asia, Southeast Asia, like South America and other places. All the participants, every one of them said like, thank you for giving me the space to share. I never thought about it this way. Like we were the first persons to have ever asked about their search habits, you know, in that sense. So I was like, wait a second, like, you know, you're telling me things that are very different than like what I learned from like Maryland in 2013. And there was just sort of like, oh yeah, no one's ever asked me about this. So I was like, oh my gosh, what? Like, this is super important. We went to a deep dive of a health search for age 11 for one of the youth who is now 21, but she was talking about herself as 11. The really traumatic searches that they had to do, like searching for, is their mom dying, right? Like they were searching for cancer at the age of 11 and trying to figure out like, oh my gosh, like I know my parents don't want to tell me all this, but they had to, right? Like, and so there's murmurs of like, why am I searching for cancer? Like, you know, why am I doing this, right? Well, it turns out like, you know, there's a lot of trauma, a lot of things that go on with this kind of searching. We deep dived into a college student who immigrated here in the seventh grade, but still does searches for parents and older sisters actually in another country, right? They're actually searching and brokering. When they go back to Guyana, like they actually do a lot more searching. They're actually helping their sister so that the sister can actually help. So there's again, this sort of sibling kind of thing. So we're taking a more deep dive. I haven't finished this part of today. We're still going into it, but kind of like lessons learned or things that, these are kind of more questions that I have, to be quite honest, and lessons learned. One of the big questions I have is search and brokering like the same as cleaning your room for you, right? I put this like clean, because when we ask the youth like about like their kinds of habits, some of them dismiss it as if it's like cleaning their room. But like when in fact, like they're doing like really high level stuff, like this is like really, and so where does this sort of responsibility, where does digital responsibility like this fit, right? It's not like there's a journal of cleaning or the journal of chore studies, right? There's a journal of information studies. There's like, we study information retrieval. We study this kind of stuff. We don't study exactly like cleaning our rooms or cooking dinner, like family response. We do have some of a little bit of that, but you know, on what level is search and brokering this? Like, where is it fit in family responsibility, especially the high stakeness of certain things? You know, sort of ask this question, like, is there like a search identity? Like, particularly as youth grow up, like what happens as they think about themselves as searchers, right? For their families, as they kind of grow into these positions. Some of them are glad that they're done. Some of them will still keep doing this, right? Particularly, you know, right now, these are two stories about search or no, right? Both public and private. you have on the left side right here, like a very recent story in July coming out about how kids translate speaking only Spanish. And then you have also like mainstream, right? Very interesting stories are coming out now about particular like larger middle-class families doing the search now. So what's public and private now, right? When we start to understand these things, these are really, some stories are very sensitive. Like we can't go into this kind of stuff. Some stories are like, let's celebrate in this case. And that's a really big tension that we sort of feel in this kind of work. Is there like a search perception, right? Like as I grow older, how does the constant need to search for families change the way I think about search or influence the way I think about myself as a searcher? And going back to the title of the talk, like designing for invisible work, a lot of these searches are happening on robust search engines. Nobody, not a single person I have ever talked to as a kid says, I went to a kid search engine to do this stuff, right? No one. And so it's not really, you know, we've known this for a while. It's not really worth building a search engine for kids because they're not using them. It's not the way they are using the same adult tools as, so then what is the really big question about design then, right? We also know that searching is collaborative, but it's also emotional and frustrating, right? That this is not like this document, this is a search. So I put the word remicade in there because this is actual real search that a kid did when I first interviewed them back in Brooklyn. And this is the search that a 12-year-old had to do for their mother who, like, again, may have had some problems taking this drug. And they were talking a lot about like the sort of things that they feel, you know, the frustration. And so when I look at this like design, I'm like, well, then how, if I know that collaborative searching can be frustrating and emotional, then what part of design can help us out here in this case? And, you know, it's not just youth that are doing the brokering. I'm going to make this argument now. It's just that I'm actually studying like more of a subset of people doing this kind of work. But as you get older, as all of us get older, maybe our families, like, you know, we'll have to like, you know, won't understand the searching, maybe actually a lot of help, especially around this COVID vaccine stuff in this case. All of us may have to end up doing this kind of work for our families, right? We will have to do so it may not be exact English to another language translation, but there is going to be translational work. Someone may have to search for these things for older adults or for different kinds of members of our community. And so just by studying this particular group of young people sort of gives us a sense. So I'm going to close the talk with this quote right here. I've been told that psychologists are now saying having children involved in so many adult decisions is not good for them. Who are we going to rely on when we need help, especially when it's about information that is private and personal? And that's sort of the takeaway right here, right? Like, it is a really interesting way of happening, things that are happening with youth in the sense, this is from a parent. So again, thank you for this opportunity. It feels like coming home because this is Maryland. This is like my people. I mean, I'm at University of Washington, but you know, HCIL Green, like thank you for watching too. So yeah, I'm kind of done. So happy to feel taking questions or things on your mind or things like that.
Okay. Well, oops, here, I'll turn on the video. Thank you very much for the really interesting talk, Jason. I mean, we were expecting that and you delivered. We were doing amazing stuff. Yeah. The chat is available and also the Q&A is available. So anybody who wants to ask questions, you can post it there. If it's a short question, I'll just repeat it. If it's a longer question, I'll probably just give you the ability to talk. Mary Ann had asked a question. It's really interesting. When you're looking at the processes you're talking about or the behaviors and the activities you're talking about, her question is kind of how are the search results assessed? Or made sense of during this process. And I think part of what we're interested in there is, you know, there's a lot of discussion about misinformation and disinformation and good information and bad information. And, you know, have you seen that as a something that they're paying attention to and thinking about as they
It gets a little tricky and it was really complicated when we were, there are a couple of things kind of come to my mind. One is if we talk about misinformation, disinformation, that kind of stuff, you know, we know that from like research and other things that like, you know, lower SES families, particularly immigrant refugees, are targeted for this kind of stuff. We see it as well with like scams, multi-level marketing, cryptocurrency, as much as whatever you think about cryptocurrency, you know, those kind of things. And then also the fact about like, so we have that side of interpretation or at least targeting certain community groups. Then we have the other very complicated side of things where it's like, oh my gosh, like for example, that Remicade search I did, like the kid who did this search, like found Remicade, found accurate, very accurate information on Remicade because it was coming from NIH, but had no idea how to interpret it, right? And so it's like this, like there's like multiple like aspects of assessment on this level. One is the whole like, oh my gosh, like people are like throwing misinformation, disinformation out there. People can't filter it. But then what happens? Well, just sort of like we table that a little bit. Then there's also this other aspect, like, well, the information's super accurate, but like the user can't figure out what to say about it. They don't have there's everything in between all of that. So the assessment during the processes is a really tricky one because it kind of depends on whether or not like how each of them sort of go through it all and figure this out. Like some of the, again, like that construction siding example where, you know, they found the result, but it was not what the mother wanted. The child's like, here it is. And then the parent was like, this is not it. And so how do you refine those things? How do you go back? And so there's also this sort of check and balance between like, how, you know, that sort of regulation process we have as individuals, well, that also comes out as like a collaboration. And so there's so many different kinds of things you have to think about with that particular question about, you know, high accuracy, hard to interpret, low accuracy, hard to interpret, accurate, but not, you know, but it's like, it's so, I think it's just so many different layers to think about, especially as like, it's like, and then, you know, as, especially as age factors and cognition and like, the way youth have to do this kind of work, it gets even more complicated. They're not just searching for dinosaurs online, or no one's searching for Justin Bieber anymore, but like when they were, like maybe they're searching for BTS now in this case, right? But there's that and then all the other things in between. So yeah. It's kind of how I sort of interpret that question.
That makes sense. And there was another question that was also asked, again, I think you may have already addressed it, but it's, do you consider or encounter problems with children not really understanding what they're even reading online? With younger children searching for serious information like financial and medical, and you kind of touched on that with the, you know, they found something that was accurate, but it was from NIH, and it just
I'll even go to the most simple one I can think of. Right, we've had families that are like, maps are really big right now, directions, right? So we have families who were basically saying, I can't, like a really good example is there was another story where we had a family. Basically said like they had been scammed and then they had to like, you know, get a new card, new Bank of America card. So the mother or the parent asked the child like, hey, like, could you find me the information on like the closest Bank of America near us? And the kid was like, all right. So they go into Google Maps and they just, you know, find it and here it is, right? The problem was that the kid had no idea how to read a map. It's like they knew how to like type in Bank of America. They knew where it is, but they're just like, here it is. I have no idea where this is, but here. So you can have information that's found, but like even the most simplest thing of a map, like they didn't understand the icon, they didn't understand any of that. And the parent was like, okay, I'm gonna take over. Like, cause like we're here. So the parent knew how to like figure out maps, right? They just didn't know how to interpret like how to do the search and back. And it, you know, it sounds really simple. You're like, well, just type Bank of America into Google Maps. But like for some of them, they're just like, no, I want my kid to do it and I'll do the rest, right? A lot of it was like, let me just kickstart a little bit. And then like, if they could just get me along the way, kind of like training, if they could just push the bike a little bit, then I can go on the two wheels myself. But it's really interesting when actually you find information that you can't interpret, but it's actually really, like it's correct. Like there it is. There's the map. It was right there. Even I was looking at it and I was like, okay, yeah, like that's right. Like, but the kid was like, but I have no idea. Like, I don't, where is this thing? Like, I can't tell you where it is. Like, they have no spatial geography in that way. Yep. So there's lots of different stories we have about that one in this case. So yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So we have another question from Kaiwen Sun, and I'll just allow you to talk so you can ask the question directly. So Kaiwen, go ahead. You can unmute and ask your question.
Yeah, just really quick. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, you're great.
Jason, thank you so much for a great talk. We met at Glasgow 2019. I was right next behind you. Yeah. So I was wondering if the parents' tech savviness play any role in the search processes. For example, if a parent who doesn't speak English but may have some knowledge of technology or very savvy, would the search process be affected, or how that might affect how parents guide their children through the search processes?
Yeah, that's a really good question. That's one of the reasons why we didn't interview like Microsoft or Google employees, like who might be English language learners, but oftentimes may have the tech, because it was just like, but because that does actually play a huge role into it, right? Or even social capital is a really good one. Like definitely how the parents viewed the technology mattered quite a bit. A lot of them didn't understand, like they understood how to use their smartphones, but they did not understand how to access really important forms. So FAFSA will be probably the biggest example in America. Like if you wanna think about like student loans as an undergraduate, you go through FAFSA, which is one of the most confusing, complex processes. Like if you ask any family who fills out a FAFSA, even for like mainstream families, like that's, it's a huge problem. It's even harder. And so tech savviness comes in. It's like, well, wait a second, how do I fill out a PDF? Like, how do I upload this thing? Like, can I find this on my phone? Why can't I fill the information out on my phone? Like, you know, how do I upload like the bank statements, or how do I figure out like, you know, so that simple thing about, no, I wouldn't call it simple, that complex issue of FAFSA matter is a really good example of parents having to like, not they're just like, they're kind of floored at like, I don't know how to do this, right? We've seen kids like, or even simple things like the password retrieval. I mean, even with searching is really interesting, because now so much of it is like attached to an account, right? So if you think about a Google account or something like that, it pops up like, please put your password in. And the parents are like, I just want to search, I don't have a password, right? Like some of them are that get floored by that one. So much of the technology literacy, not just about how to use the technology, but also what is it good for, right, is another question. For some families, when we ask like the ones at EACS, is this the first time you brought a laptop home? And they're like, yeah, like the school gave it out. So, and we also knew that like, this might be the first, you know, because everything was online schooling, this parents are using those same Chromebooks the way kids are in this case. So that to us is always like, oh my gosh, like, yeah, they haven't, you know, this is sort of it's an interesting question about like tech literacy and the usage of it, particularly as like, you know, this isn't going away. Like I said, the big question of like, is this like cleaning your room? And I'm like, my simple answer is like, no, it's not. But part of me is always a little bit shocked that like kids think that it is, like, it's like cleaning my room. Why are we talking about this? And I'm just like, because this is not like cleaning your room, right? So much is so different in a sense.
Well, and we had a couple other questions, but I think just to, so we have time, because we want to keep to a time. Thank you, Jason. It's been a great talk. I suspect that if you had a burning question, you could send Jason an email.
Yeah, you can feel free to ping me an email. It's JCYIP. Type in the chat or find me on Twitter. Happy to talk to you University of Maryland folks, or if you're not University of Maryland, so happy to talk to you in this case. So feel free to chat, and like, you know, hopefully I'll see some of you one day. I haven't been back to Maryland in a year, so I kind of miss it. I really want to come back at some point.
And I'll hand it back to Marianne.
Yeah, thank you, Jason. That was really, really interesting. And we can tell your enthusiasm about the about your subject matter. So we hope you'll come back for an update maybe next year when you have some new stories to tell us. And that's sort of a way of moving into thanking everybody for joining the Search Mastery speaker series this spring semester. This is our last talk for now. We'll be in touch with announcements over the, you know, as we get closer to the fall semester about our next series for the for fall. And if you have questions, if you have ideas, if you have thoughts, further interest in the group activities or anything like that, you can just you can email me. And this is my email address, or you can contact anybody that's in the group, and everybody knows how to find Brian too. So Brian, any closing comments before we wrap up?
Thank you everybody for joining us and participating, and have a good summer.
Yep.
Take care, folks.
Thanks. Bye. Everybody.